Yeah. Rum red alert. Lockdown time. Yeah. All right, that's enough. Enough of that. Hey, everybody. All right, let's take a look at the feed here. It's got my asthma acting up. We got a pollen alert in Philly. It's I'm got the usual pollen thing, so don't be concerned. It's my usual everyday thing. It's kind of early in the day for me to be talking. So it might be some phlegm. All right, waiting for the looking at the chat. We've got 114 people on and a chat rate of 10. Oh, battling the phlegm the last few weeks. All the pollen is just off the charts. We had such a warm winter and everything's blooming. It's like it's March and it's like it's the plants are behaving like it's May. It's just crazy. So, hey everybody, looking at the chat, I got warnings popping up. YouTube is telling me that I don't have a bit rate high enough. That I'm not transmitting at high enough bit rate, but I should be hearing the audio. I'm using my good mic because the audio on this Logitech webcam is just terrible. So I hated the audio playback. So I've got my really good mic on. So I should be able to hear me much better this time. All right. Everyone's coming in. Hello. All right. It's going very, very fast. A few things I wanted to talk about. First thing is, during this week on the YouTube has been sending out all these notices. One of them was this one here. Yeah, this one is because of the thing that they're not going to have as many human reviewers to review videos, and unfortunately, as a result, we may remove content that does not violate our community guidelines. So, as a result of getting this particular notice, I'm being very careful about the content I put up because videos can, basically what they're saying is videos can get deleted and there's no there's no human review, which is really weird because I would think that Google I think that they would make it super easy for people to like review videos from home. I don't get it. It's just so I'm being very careful about the content that I put up and everything. I don't want to get slammed or because there's no oversight. The other thing, and Dave Jones did a video, which you can look. I don't have it here, but Dave talked about it. But we were talking in private about this thing because I'd seen this thing pop up. YouTube has started to give us these when we go to our content review, like for comments, go to the comments page, and YouTube has given us these handy auto replies so that we can robo reply our fans and reply to comments. It's just so weird. Sorry, Quakeskin, using you as an example, but this was the first that it came up, so I just took a screenshot of it in the comments feed. But yeah, it's like Google wants us to click on these auto bot, and the scary thing about this is that this is the Googlebot's AI processing questions and trying to come up with suitable answers. And really, I thought that was really weird. I am never going to do that. I hope that they give an option to be able to turn that off, because yeah, it's just I no real content creator would ever want to do that, because the very salt of being a content creator on YouTube is reading the comments and responding to comments. If I'm going to respond personally, I'm not going to be a bot. Just, you know, the idea that a content creator would just want to farm out their replies or like to a bot, or, you know, I guess the idea is that you're putting the effort to do the click, you know, rather than actually typing words. But it's just, I worry about accidentally clicking one of those things when I'm trying, because they put those big tiles right under the line where you're actually going to type a real reply. It'd be so easy to accidentally auto reply. It's just making it so. And Dave Joe's found out, because he has two channels, that only on his big channel did the auto reply thing come up. So it seems, at least anecdotal evidence, is that they're only offering this auto reply feature for 100K plus channels, which makes it even more mystifying, you know? Anyway. So, I gotta read the chat. There's a lot of chat. I'm getting hyperventilated. I'm getting all worked up. We got in local news lots of shortages. This is what it looked like. This is what it looked like at the Acme. That's the bread aisle. Plenty of peanut butter and jelly, but no bread. A lot of people. I put this on the blog page, community page, and a lot of people were commenting, well, bake your own bread. Well, I would, but I'm really not a baker. But my diet is really restricted. This is one of the things. This period of time is very hard on me. Number one, I live alone, and I don't have a lot of support structure. I mean, I don't really know many people. My diet is very restricted these days because of just lots of reasons. I'm lactose intolerant. I've been lactose intolerant since my 40s, but I always depended on like cheese, like for protein and nutrition. But even like in the past like 6 months, 4 months or whatever, I've been, you know, even unable to digest cheese anymore. So like my lactase enzyme levels are down to the point where I can't even digest cheese. That was like a huge, you know, so anything with dairy in it or cheese in it, I can't eat it. It just makes me sick. And the stress of the last few weeks, I did that video about stress relief, and which I practice every day, but even with that, you know, I've, getting a lot of, it's been tough with the stress, and I get, you know, I have all kinds of anxiety-related physiological issues, you know, irritable digestion and everything, and when I get high stress, I gotta like have a simpler diet and, you know, eat a lot of like bread and rice and beans and stuff. But, you know, my staples of my diet, like for protein, I eat egg white omelet every day, and eggs are like unattainable, you know, and beans are like my major source of protein too, and beans can't be bought, so. It's like you can't buy bread, so, you know, I'm supposed to be on a blander bread diet for the digestion, but can't buy bread, so it's been very tough on me, and not being able to have resources, and having to be rationing my food. I mean, I have food in the pantry and stuff, but the food I have is, you know, it's not ideal for me to eat, and so my health is suffering from the fact that I just can't get nutrition. I don't have access to really proper food right now, which is causing me more stress than just about anything. Oh, and before I get to the chat, I wanted to thank my patrons if they're tuning in. What I really feared, when this whole thing happened, you know, like a week and a half, 2 weeks ago, when it all started, my real fear was that as people were working from home or maybe you know, being laid off or something, that you know, my Patreon would collapse and my support would go away. But that hasn't happened. I just, my Patreon support is pretty steady. Some people had to reduce their pledges, understandably. Some people had to bow, but you know, vast majority are hanging tight, and that's just made that has made this far less stressful than it would otherwise be, because without that Patreon support, I'd be in a severe problem. So thank you, patrons. Thank you. The Patreon support, it's everything. You know, it's everything. It means everything to me. So thank you, patrons at Patreon, for keeping the lights on here. All right, let's read the support. Let's get to the chat. Ever tried dried beans? I have, yeah. The problem with dried beans is that they make me really gassy. Canned beans have the least gas response, but dried beans are like, yeah. Even after you cook them and soak them and cook them and everything, it's just, no, it's just lethal levels of gas with dried beans. So I gotta go with canned. Oh, you look great. Thank you, Dwight. I love the moonscape. Thanks. Yeah, it's my backdrop. I love using the backdrop. Going to another town to shop for an option. Well, no, because outside of Philly, it's worse. It's worse. Hey, greetings from Lisbon. Hello, Alex. Hello, hello. All right. Hello. John says the moonscape is cool. Lord Montague. Yes, a very familiar name. Thanks, Lord Montague, from the patrons. People just need to chill out and follow the guidelines. Yes, yes. That's the thing. You know, my doctor is really great. I've got like the best doctor in the world, and she's been communicating with me through email, and her very advice was, because I get out, my primary exercise is walking, and that's how I get, you know, with my arthritis and everything, I can't like do treadmill and shit like that. I don't go to a gym. I've never gone to a gym because I'm basically a germaphobe anyway, and gyms are like where you go to get sick, basically. So I get all my exercise from walking around. You know, I go for a long walk, an hour and a half walk through the city. That has always been how I get my exercise. And, you know, being locked in, you know, I've been worried about getting too close to people, running into people, and, you know, breathing their breath and stuff. Just, you know, because when you get out in the street, you know, the sidewalks can get narrow, and you've got to pass people. People get behind you, in front of you, and people, you know, standing outside of buildings smoking and, you know, hanging out and everything. It's just, you can't avoid people if you're in the city. And when you're outside, the 6-foot rule doesn't apply when you got 20 mile an hour wind blowing and someone who's smoking like, you know, a block away, you can smell their cigarette smoke. It's like, well, you're breathing what they're breathing. It's like, that's the reality of the city. But, you know, I expressed my concerns to her, and her reply to me was very specific. In fact, I put it up on the thing. She said that, she told me that it was more important for me to get out and walk around, that the risk to my health from not exercising was greater than the chance of me getting sick from walking around outside. And she told me just, you know, to take precautions to avoid people, you know, walk around in less busy times. Here's one thing, though. I did reconnaissance. I got in my car and drove to the west side of town, where I thought, you know, there are parks, you know, big parks on the west side of town. And I went to was going to go to Fairmount Park, thinking that, you know, people would be locked down and everything, and maybe it would be, you know, wouldn't be that many people there. I could go there and walk around, but I did not even go into the parking lot, because when I even got, like, I was like a quarter mile away from the park, and there were thousands of people, like, just, the sidewalks were just packed with people, you know, babies in strollers, families, people just, it looked like summer, you know, it looked like a summer day, summer Saturday, and it was just so many people just crowding around, you know. My sister said, oh, you know, I talked to her the other day, and she was like, oh, you know, neighbors are having a big party, and there's, you know, they just had all these people just, you know, hooping it up and drinking, and, you know, just the, and, yeah, so people are just, not doing this, you know, and so it's like all of us, you know, who are, you know, staying home to try to make this better, the people who don't are, you know, and the argument is that there's this large growing group of people who are saying, oh, this is all bullshit. We got to let this thing play out. It's just like the flu. Everyone's going to get it and everyone's going to get over it, you know, and some people won't, yada, yada. And, you know, you get it once and you got immunity. And that's not how it works. It's like, you don't get immunity from the flu if you get it once. You get it every year. And it's not like you get a cold when you're a kid and you never get a cold again. You know, if this thing's let to go around, if it becomes the flu, then it goes around every year and everyone's going to get it every year. And every year it's going to mutate. And every year it'll get more severe and more lethal. And so if you think, oh, I'm just going to get it once, and so I'm just going to violate curfew and just, you know, have my party and hang out, you know, as much as I can, well, because I'll be fine. Well, you'll be fine, but you're screwing all the people who aren't going to be fine, who are going to get it because you got it, you know, because the more people who get it, then the more opportunity the virus has to mutate, and that's you know, how it becomes worse. That's why we're all supposed to not be hanging out with each other, and that's why we're supposed to be avoiding each other. But there's so many people who don't get that. They don't understand, or they don't care. You know, they don't care. And that's making this so much worse. If everyone was on board, this would be over quick. But that's just not the case, you know. The logic of the let's get it and get over it is the logic of that argument is not based in science. If everybody was doing the, oh, let's just carry on and be like normal, then, you know, we'd be losing 3% of our population just from one infection every year, and it'd be mutating every year, and everybody be getting it every year in the new version. And that would be the new normal is, you know, and that's what people think that would be good, you know. No, you know, the whole idea of quarantining ourselves is to flatten that curve so we don't overwhelm resources and systems, and to give us a chance to, you know, to curb the spread, to give time for science to come up with other treatments and vaccines, and to change our protocols and the way that we you know, deal with each other and travel. And I think a few good things will come out of this. One is that the only reason this has been allowed to happen is the same reason why we still have the flu. You know, the people are like, oh, I'll get it and then we have immunity. Well, you don't have immunity from the flu for life. And why do we have the flu every year? You know, why didn't we eliminate the flu like we eliminated polio and other things? Well, because people don't take it seriously. And because we've had a culture pretty much worldwide where if you get sick, you go to work. If you get sick, you go to the shop. If you get sick, you hang out with your family, and you all get sick. And if you get sick, you go to the shop. And people who publicly sneeze on people and projectile sneeze and cough on people, and people, that behavior was just, you know, people got away with that, you know. And you could travel sick, you know. Up until this, you could be deathly ill and get on a plane. You could be deathly ill and get on a bus. You could be deathly ill and get on a train. You know, and if you had the full-blown flu at work, probably nobody would call you out on it, and everybody at work would get the flu, and that's the way it was until now. So what could be a good thing is if everybody is made, not the people who just won't change, but if social rules are changed to make it so that these kinds of behaviors are no longer acceptable, and if we have new systems in place to, like, for travel and stuff, to make sure that people who are traveling are healthy, you know, that those innovations will make a huge difference, not just in this, but with all the other things that are going to come on, and including the flu. You know, the flu shouldn't be the big thing that it is, but it is. But it's the big thing that it is because people don't wash their hands, shops don't clean, didn't used to clean surfaces. You know, you'd go out in public, nothing was ever cleaned before, and sick people would be like just out among, you know. People would go to the restaurant sick, you know. I would be in the cafe, local cafe, and, you know, some young person would be, you know, sitting at the bar, trying to have breakfast. They'd be you know, they'd be so sick, And you know, but they're like too like, oh, I'm too sick, but I'm also too privileged to cook breakfast for myself. So I've got the flu, but I'm just going to come down here and have breakfast, and then I'm going to go out and have lunch, and then I'm going to go out to have dinner every day because I don't cook even though I'm sick. And that, all that stuff, that's why the flu goes running around the world. And that's why it mutates every year. And so I'm hopeful that on the other side of this, human behavior will change to a point where maybe we can deal with all of these kinds of things, not just this one, but all of them, you know, and that would be a good thing. All right, here endeth the rant. Let's check. Okay, we got 235 people. Average watch time, 4 minutes, 33 seconds. Yeah. All right. Chat's going so fast. So fast. Reading the chat. Hope you're faring well. Well, I think I explained my. You can hit the back button and go back to my talking about the challenges in the first 5 minutes of my talking, the challenges. Hopefully, all of you are working at home. Air conditioning, yeah. Many people only think about themselves. That's true. There's probably like a significant double-digit percentage of the population that only think of themselves, and boy, we're sure seeing them out hooping it up these days. Chicago and the entire state are in lockdown until April 7th. Yep, it's... I mean, Philadelphia, we're the same thing here, you know. people are talking about stuff, yeah, about bacteria and virus. Yeah, but the problem is with a virus, if you're immunocompromised and you get a virus, then you get secondary infections, and that's the thing. That's the thing, is that the, I know people are talking about the flu, about those epidemics from years and years ago, but, you know, lots of differences. It's apples and oranges. Society was different, medicine was different, human behavior is different. There's lots of differences. What we're doing, this whole lockdown thing, is an experiment. It's an experiment, and hopefully it'll work. I see people talking medical stuff, medical. Yeah, I don't want to read all that. Kicked out of the LCBO. What's the LCBO? I don't know what that is. For wearing a mask. I don't know what that is, LCBO. Yeah, people are talking about the medical stuff, so I guess there's nothing for me. I guess I'm looking at the chat for any questions or anyone wanting to ask me anything, but the chat is just sort of going on its own. Okay, someone's asking, how are things financially now? Is the lab thriving or is it tough? We're doing okay. Got nothing to complain about, you know. Like I said earlier, patrons are holding strong. I haven't been losing Patreon support, which is extremely great. So yeah, the patrons are holding up the weight of the lab through all this, which is making it much easier for me. Reading the chat. It's going to rain, so it's time for sciencing. And indeed, it is. It's going to rain like all week. I saw the forecast. It's not an experiment. It's as real as it gets. Well, it's both. An experiment is real. An experiment is something you do for real to test if something will work. It is an experiment by definition. Experiments are real. I'm hoping that I read the FDA website, and they had some very good posts. They said that the that in the U.S. the food supply chain is healthy and good, but the food supply is good. It's just the supply chain has been depleted. So I'm hoping that in the next week or so, that the distribution of foodstuffs will somewhat normalize, even to a point where it's possible to get things in small quantities. I'm hoping that I'm not going to have to ration my food for another week, because then I'm just going to get sick from malnutrition. That's the thing, you know. You know, so... ozone-producing lights. Well, you don't want to breathe ozone. That's the thing. You know, you don't want to be breathing in ozone. You know, people talking medical stuff. Is anybody? Oh, how do you manage to become so incredibly creative? Says John 72392. How do you manage to become so incredibly creative? Boredom. Boredom. I don't know. I struggle with trying to be creative. Oftentimes I think that I'm really not being creative, you know. In fact, that's actually like a fear of mine, of not being productive, not doing something interesting. And having the channel requires me to be interesting and do interesting things and think of interesting things. It's sort of my job now to be creative. I guess it's the same pressures as being a professional artist. You know, if you're an artist and you do it for a long time, and then you get to a point where you're doing it for a living, the pressure to be creative. Or writers, you know, writers suffer with that, you know, getting writer's block and stuff like that. So I don't know, there's no secret sauce. Actually, it's hard. When I'm under stress, it's very hard to be creative, you know, because I'm worrying all the time. I'm like right now, like I did that video about, you know, worry and everything, and I use all those techniques. But, you know, this week, I mean, I've been worrying about, you know, my food, because I've been rationing my food. I've been worrying about my physical health from not getting out to exercise. Although my doctor told me the other day that I should just get out, which I'm going to be doing carefully, and. You know, other things. I think that, if food becomes readily available, my health is going to be better, and if I can get to walking again, all that stuff. Oh, okay, Joachim Winterberg says, hey, Joachim. Am I pronouncing your name right, Joachim? Joachim, I hope I'm pronouncing it right. Any news on the art project? Can we buy? I painted a couple new ones. Got a new one. This one's not done yet. This one's in progress. I got to fill in. This is gonna be black in the middle there. But I got the two coats of red on, and I got the white and yellow is painted. So but this is one. I like this one. It's kind of that's cool. I'm still working on this. I've painted almost all the canvases I got. I ordered a bunch. I gotta go to the post office this week and pick up. I got some smaller ones that might be more mailable. These are a little big to put in an envelope. But I got some 2x2s, which it's gonna be kind of interesting painting on 2x2 canvas. But I think the 2x2s might be more like mailable to like sell or do like as a promotional thing. That way, you know, you can put it in a padded envelope and mail it just in the regular mail pretty easily with some protection. Working on it. Still working on it. Looks like you need some sun. Because I'm pale? Oh, I am extremely melanin deprived. I don't tan at all. I just get red. So in the summertime, it's sunblock, and I don't tan. I'm always this sort of bluish, bluish beige, blue because of the German. I got the German prominent vessels, so I'm got a lot of blue everywhere. looks like an egg yolk, yeah. Oh, I got a painting in the, it's on my art website, Paul Klee and Kurt Schwitter's Escape Space Time at Breakfast is the name of a panel painting I did years ago that has like a Dadaist egg in space through the rift in time with a Klee arrow and everything. It's on the contourcourses.com art site. John says, if you were closer, I'd give you some food. You know, I actually, oh, it's cool. I do have friends who are not like really close, but that have some provisions that have offered that, you know, if it goes on, if it gets to a point where, like this week, if provisions still aren't available, I'm going to have to start, taking up offers to take some from other people's stashes. Wash your hands and keep 2 meters away from the zombie apocalypse. Yeah, and actually, here's an interesting thing, because I did a video which I have people, I got a couple of people asking me about the dust mask video, which I unlisted that because of the warning from YouTube that that content that might be controversial might get flagged or banned or slammed. So as a precaution, that video sort of went around. It's still there, but I unlisted it just as a protection mechanism. But one of the interesting things is that in that video, I talked about how the water droplets would dry up very quickly in the air. And some people were like, oh, that you're talking nonsense. But actually, over the past week, just out of curiosity, I was doing water droplet research and found a scientific paper from the 90s. It's on this EDU site, this university study. And they actually tested empirically water droplet evaporation they were doing clinical studies on immunology for hospitals and stuff, sepsis control and stuff like that. So they had this laboratory set up where they made droplets in the laboratory in all these different conditions, and they said actually that the evidence from their experiments and showed that droplets of the size that are created by a human speech and sneezing and coughing and such, that the droplets will, most of those droplets will completely evaporate before even falling 2 meters to the ground. So it was a very interesting piece of data. But that's exactly what I had said, you know, that the droplets are evaporating very quickly. And it was interesting that I had found a study that said that exactly right. I was spot on, like 100%. Building a fort, yes. If I had 14 of these, I'd have like a fort built out of a moonscape. Sunscreen, the benzos in sunscreen. I mean, it's like, what are you gonna do? You know, it's like what's the bigger risk, the exposure to benzos or ultraviolet radiation? Because ultraviolet radiation is a real risk, especially for someone as light-skinned as me. So it's like, you gotta, this is what it comes down to. Life is all about risk. That's, you know, I know. I mean, I have become very risk-averse in my older years. When I was younger, I mean, the things I did were very cavalier and not, well, I've got health problems because I didn't take precautions with a lot of my work and stuff, exposure to chemicals and things like that. So I have respiratory, you know, issues and stuff, all the painting and sanding and shit that I did, you know, when I was young. I think, you know, when it comes, even as someone like myself who's prone to anxiety and risk aversion, when it boils down to it, life is all about risk, you know. There's only so much you can do, and there's only so much in life that you can ever control, and the rest is just you have to accept risk. That doesn't mean that you should be stupid, But I'm trying to get to the point where, like everybody, or I can just sort of not worry about having to take the minimum risk to do what I gotta do. All right, I'm gonna hold on a second. I'm going to go and get a cookie. It's live, so there's no pause button, but I'm getting low blood sugar, so fortunately I was able to score a some vanilla cookies. So I've been nibbling on these to get over the sugar thing, so cookies, yeah. Eat them if you got them, right? I hope I got enough for all of us. Yeah, you can all have a little bit. Cookies are the new vitamins. Well, it's like I've been trying to live off the land. It's like you gotta get what you can get. And you can't get bread, but they had cookies, so, you know, it's like, is that a Corona typewriter? Oh, that's an Olympia. I think it's like late 40s, early 50s. It's got the Bakelite keys, this is like the typewriter I always wanted. You know, with the real molded Bakelite keys. And they're two-shot molded, so the letters are actually Bakelite too. It's not like stamp printed, it's like a two-shot process, so it's like really cool. But yeah, I love that typewriter. It's my favorite. Dates. Dates are a very good source of calories. I love dates. I usually don't get like really sugary fruits like dates and raisins, but in this scarcity, trying to get any kind of food with calories in it has been very difficult, so cookies will have to do. Bran, do you have a ham radio license? No, I get asked that a lot. I'm not a ham because I live in the city, you know. I got nowhere to hang an antenna. I can't even receive shortwave in the city because the you know, we have these ground level cell relay things that the cell tower is like right at the window level, so like anything in the shortwave is really tough. Like my Heathkit clock goes off the WWE. It just picks up mostly just noise, you know, and just this squeak, it's just, you just hear that data noise, you know. It's shortwave is just not doable in the city. Bakelite is so fragile these days. Well, they don't really, you know, it depends. Real phenol, there's not too many places that use real phenolic resin. My knobs, the old Davies knobs from my Frantone pedals, they used to be real Bakelite. And I went through great pains. It was very, very painful to get real Bakelite knobs made because it's just such a difficult process and there's really just no one really making stuff out of Bakelite nowadays. Alright. Should have emergency radio in case the internet goes out. Well, I've got tons of radios. I have radios that'll pick up shortwave, it's just you can't pick up shortwave. But I've got tons of radios. Got them in every room. Every room got radios. Oh, someone says they're a big fan of my pedals. Hello. Thank you. Let's see what we got here on the stats. We're getting 290 people hanging out. All right. How about more flight adventures? Well, I'd like to do that. Actually, I talked with Howard. We might do some more future. But I mean, we can't do anything now, while all this is going around. So, but oh, I'd like to. Hello from Norway. Hello. Do they ever turn on spontaneously and keep you out? I mean, my radios? No, not really. They all have switches, Fran, what happened to the Heathkit build? The clock? Well, I finished the clock. Do you watch comedy to relax? Sometimes. I was watching Monty Python and the Holy Grail late last night. And I loaded up a bunch of Mystery Science Theater 3000 episodes I've been watching too. Friend, who are some of your favorite engineer heroes? I don't know. I mean, there are so many engineers, but I didn't really. It's tough. I mean, I'm self-taught. I didn't really look. I have like heroes, It's. I guess it doesn't really apply. I mean, I respect a lot of engineers, but I've never really, like, worshipped. I guess engineers in general. What movies are people watching? Yeah, I got a lot on my DVR. I've been sort of storing up, Any new design for a pedal? No, I'm not making pedals anymore because there's just no. I can't really produce pedals, so I'm not designing them. I figure, if someone wants to, if someone wants to contract me out to design pedals for their company, like an established company, like that could actually like. Pay me like for my time, which is significant when you're designing a new pedal. It's a lot of time. Then sure, I would be up for that. Someone else is watching MST3K tonight. Oh, on Comet. Oh, that's cool. Yeah, I think I've been getting mine off IFC or something because they have the HD version. Although those were all just those were NTSC, but try to get the higher band version. In my service in the Comcast. Comet is like it's really low baud. It's like hardly watchable. It's like really, it's barely like the resolution is so, yeah. It's like dial-up. Hello from South London. Hello. Oh, the Picard series. Yeah, it's stream. So I don't have any streaming services, so I haven't watched Picard, but I hear the reviews are raving. Land of the Lost. Oh, jeez. Like the old series, the Sid Marty Krofft. Yeah, I haven't seen that in decades. Someone says, Oh yeah, Joaquin says Bob Moog is my hero. I used to get lots of tales of Bob Moog because people in New York, knew him. I never did, but I always heard daring, tales of people who knew him. Oh, do, 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 do. Let's see. Burnt biscuits. Have you thought about designing a hi-fi preamp? Well, not really, because I mean, preamps are a very specific science. I mean, I had colleagues I knew back in New York who were like really expert at designing phono preamps and stuff. It's such a specific thing, to do it right. And there are some really great preamp builders out there who really know their stuff. But my needs are very simple. I use a mixing console, and and just for phono preamp, and I can change the EQ depending on depending on the cut of the record and the mix down of the record and stuff. So I prefer the console, more control. Hello from Australia. Oh no. Yeah, Australia. It's kind of at the end of my vision. I had this prescription, so I want to make sure it wasn't Austria. You don't want to make that mistake. All right. All right, let's see here. Okay. Oh, let's see, where are we? 50 minutes. I'm getting tired. I'm really tired. I haven't been sleeping much, and I've been rationing my food, so I don't have a whole lot of energy. So I'm gonna probably not go for 2 hours this time, and plus I'm not, on caffeine right now. Do you have any interest in having pets? No, Missy died, and I just can't go through it with another cat again. It's just too much. Can't go through the emotional loss again. Would you consider a design project from the ground up for your channel? All the time. It's a lot in the back catalog. Look in the back catalog. I haven't been doing projects recently because I'm not over at the factory. All right. All right. All right. I'm going to try something experimental here. I'm going to put this on pause for a moment. I'm going to go to the other room, but I'll be right back. Let's say, I'll be right back.
I'm back.
That's how you put the pause button on this. There are certain realities to being on a live stream when you're drinking a lot of tea. I'll let you do the math. Fran is one of the very few YouTubers who makes her own music. That's true. Well, I don't know if it's true that I'm one of the few, but I do make my own music. All right. Okay, so it's getting close to an hour. Like I said, I'm kind of tired, so I want to... Do people have any more questions? We're looking at the chat here. Looking at the chat, looking for questions. Any questions waiting for? I guess there's a delay here, so I guess I'm waiting for... what's your opinion on DIY respiratory masks made out of vacuum bags? No comment. I think you know, to do it right, there's you know, proper design. And I think, yeah, I already talked about that. I don't even want to think about it right now. Any 3D print projects? Well, no, I'm not doing my printer because I got ventilation issues. You know, I've got, no printing for a while until I can get better, like, air quality and ventilate. Because, you know, there's a problem with ventilation. Everyone's in lockdown. I don't want to have to suck air from next door. It's just, So, no, I'm not doing the printer until I get a better filtration for the VOCs, you know, which I might have a different solution for that. Might be buying a new filter system for VOCs. Do I have signed records? I do. But everyone who collects records sends up a signed records. It's just comes, you know, if you're a fan of music. I don't do that anymore, but when I was younger, I did, you know, get people to sign stuff. All right. All right, we're getting close to the top of the hour. When your ventilation is worse than 3D printer, no, the 3D printing fumes is really bad for me. I can't, really affects me really, really hard. All right. Are you going to do this every Sunday, or is the regular schedule? I'm going to try to. Going to try to. Now, I posted on the community page. Then people wanted me to try to do a weekly stream. So we'll try to do it at the same time. Someone's talking about ionic breeze. No, I very much against ionizing machines. Anything, you got to be very careful with producing ozone. There are only if the machines that are guaranteed not to produce ozone that have ionizers are very expensive, and you don't. You know, I don't want to have ozonated air in the shop. It's bad for people and stuff. You know. Ozone is, it's sort of like, it's like hydrogen peroxide in the air, you know, it's kind of the same kind of oxidizing effect, you know. It's probably great for antiseptic, but, you know, you don't want to be breathing it and living in it and all. Have I ever played through a Marshall stack? Actually, no. I've never played through a Marshall amplifier, ever. Never had that opportunity. I've got off Fenders, and I've got a PV, most of my amps, and some others. There are some others, but you know, as far as like playing out, it was always Fenders. Always got that California sound. kind of music do you like to listen to? I'm very eclectic. And in fact, I put in my vlog, the previous vlog about WPRB. They're on lockdown, so they're on their radio stations on Autobot. But I like to listen to freeform radio, non-commercial freeform radio, which I also support. And I encourage you to do the same. I love to listen to music, new music. I like to listen to radio, especially like college radio, because I like to listen to the newer music, you know, and the younger DJs, you know, they curate just as well as, you know, the DJs of my generation, and they know what's good, and I love being exposed to the new music and hearing the new stuff going around. So I'm very eager to listen to new sounds, and I also love, you know, the older 20th century music. But I collect all kinds of music, you know, from, you know, rock, blues, jazz, electronica, classical, country, old school country, rockabilly, swing, you name it. I love music. I love music. What should you to do? Looking at the thing. Why no super chats? I don't know. I haven't looked into it. I'm just kind of winging it here. You know, I don't know how to. I haven't looked into the super chat. What's your new favorite band? Favorites. I can't pick favorites. There's so much music. So much music. I mean, as far as like, you know, new artists go, as far as like recent releases that I really thought were really good. I think the new Snail Mail album, Lush, I really liked a lot. I thought that was really great. I like Snail Mail. But there's just so much great new music, you know. A lot of great Philly bands too, you know, that I used to go out and see all the time. Maybe will again, who knows. Any Kraftwerk albums? I've got all of them on vinyl, all the original ones. Yeah, and I've seen Kraftwerk play live. I saw the last tour, the Minimum Maximum tour, that's the very last tour with both Rolf and Florian, you know. Rolf Hutter still tours Kraftwerk without Florian, but it's just not, I don't know, it's just not Kraftwerk without Florian for me. I don't know. It'd be like Pete Townsend, you know, continuing to tour as The Who, or Brian May touring as Queen. It just wouldn't be the same for me. But they still do, you know, still do a hell of a show, and they're still out there doing, you know, Kraftwerk. All right, looks like the chat is kind of slowing down, so probably winding this up. We're over an hour, and I got to get something to eat. So, all right, I'm going to wind it down, and thanks, everybody. This is just going to be a short one, an hour, but, you know, maybe next week, if I can get some new food reserves and get my calories up, I won't be rationing my food. I'll have a lot more energy to expend next week. So, the chat's still going. I'll read through the chat, you know, after the, you know, it's one of the things I do after this. I'll read through the chat and, you know, any suggestions or anything for next week, put suggestions for things next week in the chat, and that you might want me to touch on or talk about or show or anything, and you know, I'll do what I can to get everything, you know, in line for next week. So, but we did it. All right. Thanks for hanging out with me, everybody. Thanks a lot, and we'll get back and do this next week, if not sooner. You know, I'll see how bored I get. If I get really bored and want to reach out and, you know, see how I might do for the time while we're in lockdown. Maybe I'll do 2 a week if I really feel totally, totally bored. Oh, someone's mentioned Roger Daltrey. I saw Roger Daltrey do the Under a Raging Moon tour solo. Back, he played the Tower Theater back in like '83 or something like that. That's the time that I saw him. But yeah. Anyway, all right, that's it. I'm gonna sign off. Thanks, everybody. Bye. Oh, wait.
Fly DBA.
Go ahead.